But first, let us bow our heads for a word of prayer. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you once again for being in your presence. Thank you for your love, your joy, and your peace. Thank you for those who have come out tonight to study your word. Heavenly Father, we thank you for allowing us to be used by the Holy Spirit and opening our understanding that we can receive a spiritual word from you tonight on these commandments that would teach us how to live for you. Bless those who wanted to be here but just could not make it. In Jesus' name, amen. So, a couple days ago, I woke up with a severe cold, so I'm trying to get over that now, so you can probably hear my nasal this sound. So, if I do a lot of coughing, just excuse me for that. Okay, but the third commandment, which is found in verse 7, we are in Exodus chapter 20, the third commandment, verse 7, but before we read that, let's do a recap on the first two. The first two commandments, thou shalt not have any other gods before me, and then thou shalt not make any graven image. We say that the first three commandments, which is the third one, you should not take my name in vain, all three of these commandments represents the worship of God. And so we went through understanding what an idol is, the title God meant. We went through those first two. So we're still in that kind of topic of worship of God, even when we get to commandment number three, which says in verse 7, and I'm reading from the New King James Version, you shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain, for the Lord will not hold him guiltless who takes his name in vain. Do not take the Lord your God's name in vain. A lot of people try to talk about this subject and try to get around it, talking about the speaking God's name in vain. So let's get into it. What is the Lord's name? And can we take his name in vain? And how do we take his name in vain? Some people say that we're not taking God's name in vain because his name is not God. God is a title. So if people say, oh my God, OMG, that they're not taking God's name in vain, I beg to differ with that. Or if they use God in any way negatively, they're not really using God's name because his name is not God, it's a title. Then my question to them then is, who are they talking about? If they say OMG, oh my God, are they talking about Buddha? Are they talking about Allah? Are they talking about the God of the Bible? Who are they talking about when people say OMG? Or maybe that's not a good enough analogy. What about Jesus Christ? People put a cuss word in between Jesus and Christ. Or they look at their kids. Bill Cosby had a lot of jokes. We said he was growing up. Say he thought his name was Jesus Christ. and because every time he turned around, his father, Jesus, can you do this? Can you, Jesus Christ? So he said they used the name negatively, right? So that's how you can take the name of it. Now, God, title. If it refers to the God of the Bible, of course you are still using his name in vain. Most people don't even know the name that Lord means, Yahweh. So they're not going to take that in vain because they don't even know that name. All we know, most of us, is God. And then when we say, when we try to differentiate between which God we're talking about, we'll say the God of the Bible. We'll say the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob before we say Yahweh, which is his real name, who is God. But we have to understand any form connected to the God of this Bible, name, title, anything that we use out of context, we're taking his name in vain. So let's go, let's see what we can find out here. So if we believe in the God who created all things, right, and revealed himself as the I Am God, then he alone is to be worshipped. Right, so we already know that. We learned that from the first and second commandment. What a contrast of today's society when they say OMG and they're doing all that all the time. You hear that all the time. On TV sitcoms, even when people say golly, gee whiz, gosh, doggone it. All these are derivatives of the title God. Now, notice when gosh, or I don't know if somebody ever heard this phrase, quit joshing me, I don't know if you ever heard of that. That also is a derivative of Jesus' name because his Hebrew name is Joshua or Yahshua. So all of these terms, Jesus, and like I said, they put a cuss word between his name or they use his name talking down to people in a negative way, all those are using God's name in vain. So let's break this down about these names. The Hebrew word nasay, N-A-S-A, translated, you shall not take, means this, lift up. That's what it means. It means to lift up. It is widely used to describe willful misuse or manipulation of an item or idea. It is used both figuratively and literally. So here are some ways it can be used. To lift up your hands and take an oath. You know, we stand in the courtroom, we take an oath. We gotta lift up our hands, right? To lift up one's hand as in restoration to honor and joy. To lift up the eyes as in love or desire of men or of God. To lift up your voice as in weeping, praying, or singing. Now, another way it is used in carrying guilt or punishment. But the third category of the same word stressed the taking away or forgiveness of sin and guilt. So the idea is this, do not lift up God's name inappropriately. That's what it says. So what it says in the King James Version or the New King James Version, do not take. Do not take, which means do not lift up God's name or use God's name inappropriately. So do not misuse his name. So the Hebrew word for name is Shem, S-H-E-M. This also means, watch this, reputation, fame, or glory. So do not misuse or manipulate God's name, which means his reputation, his glory, anything about him, we should not use it in vain. Name in the Old Testament included a description. If you know anything about Hebrew people, they were very, very into names. So when they named their children or something, they had meaning behind each name. Unlike today, we just make up names now. But they had meaning behind their name. Their names described what character, set one person apart from another. So they really put a lot into when they called someone their name. So the word Shem, which means name, also suggests something highly elevated, implying that God's name is majestic and excellent. So there is no other name, we're going to read that one too, Philippians, that says that is higher than Jesus, but then you got God the Father's name, which is Yahweh. Notice with Psalms 8 and 9, watch this, write this down, Psalms 8 and 9, I'm going to read it for you. Talks about his name. Psalms 8 and 9 proclaims that truth. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. So God's name is supposed to be majestic. God's name is supposed to be lifted up. God's name is supposed to be what? Great in our sight. God's name marks him as the most outstanding person in the universe. His name does. So when people lift up his name in vain, or they take his name out of context, or they use his name as a cuss word, or they use Jesus as a cuss word, they're taking his name in vain. So his name, watch this, his name signifies everything about his glorious nature, his reputation, his character, and his distinctiveness, setting him apart from everybody else. God's very essence is concentrated in his name. Number three, third point, misusing the name of God is clarified by the final phrase, in vain. So he says, do not take the Lord's name in vain. What does in vain mean? The Hebrew word for the word in vain is shav, S-H-A-V. It means emptiness, nothingness, vanity, emptiness of speech. It means lying. It means worthlessness. Using the Lord's name in vain is, watch this, to speak of God with irreverent and disrespect. Speaking of God in unworthy or frivolous manner, the name of the Lord is holy, in that same way He is holy. So watch this, God's name is as holy as He is. We're going to read another scripture that says that. His name is a representation of His glory, His majesty, His supreme deity. We are to esteem God's name and honor above everything else. To do any less is to take His name in vain. So if you sit there, you probably think about, yeah, how can people do it? We heard people say it. We heard people take God's name in vain. Somebody said, one preacher said, if you take God's name in vain, if you speak of Him too much and you're not talking about anything. Like, perfect example, when people walk up to people and they greet them and they say, I'm blessed and highly favored by God. Some people are saying that, could be saying that in vain, because they only saying it as a phrase. They're not saying it to be sincere. So anything, when you talk about God's name, if it's not sincere, it's in vain. That's what they're saying. So there is a larger sense in which people today take the Lord's name in vain. Those who name the name of Christ, now talking about us, not Christians, those who call ourselves Christians, let me ask you the question, can we take the Lord's name in vain?
Yes.
Yep, we can take the Lord's name in vain as well. Those who pray in His name, those who take a part of His identity, we can also take God's name in vain. That's why God will forgive us of doing so. And we're going to see how in a minute. But with deliberately and continually disobey Him. So we take His name in vain when we disobey His commands. So if God commanded us something through the New Testament and we don't take it seriously and we disobey Him, we have just taken His name in vain. Turn to Philippians, the second chapter. We're going to read a couple of verses. Philippians, near back there, the second chapter. Let's look at verse 9 and 10. Philippians, the second chapter, verse 9 and 10. I'm going to read something about the name of Jesus. Philippians, the second chapter, 9 and 10, and it says this. Therefore, God has also highly exalted Him and given Him the name, which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, of those in heaven and those on earth and those under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. So, God has given His Son the name that is above every name. So why don't we take His name in vain? You hear a lot of people take Jesus Christ, especially Jesus Christ. They really take that name in vain. It's because they don't honor God. They don't honor His Word. So we can see that in Scripture. So we as Christians, if we do that, we do it through disobeying God's commandments. So if we profess to be Christians but act, think, and speak in worldly manners, guess what we're doing? We're using the name of God, or we're taking His name in vain. So we take His name in vain when we misrepresent Christ, either intentionally or through ignorance of the Christian faith that's proclaimed in Scripture. We take the Lord's name in vain when we say we love God, but do not do what He commands. That's found in Luke 6:46. We take His name in vain. We take His name in vain, and we are in danger of hearing some of these words. I don't know if you ever heard the scripture where Jesus says on Judgment Day, some of the sinners are going to come up to Him, and Jesus is going to say, depart from me. You have to, I'm going to send you to the lake of fire. And some of these people are going to say, Jesus said this in Matthew 7, 21 through 23. Some of them are going to say, but I did not preach in your name. I cast out many demons in your name. I did many miracles in your name. And Jesus is going to say this to them. I never knew you. Away from me in the day of judgment. Isn't that something? How is it that a person who can claim to be a Christian, watch this, claim to be a Christian, and you don't even know that they don't even know Christ? So that means this, that only God knows the heart, right? So you got a lot of people who even profess to be Christians who are not, and they are, guess what, taking God's name in vain. Another point you can write down is this. God's name means salvation. Yes. His Yahweh means salvation, and watch this, Yahshua or Jesus means salvation. Yahshua is the Hebrew name for Jesus. Jesus is Greek, Yahshua is Hebrew. It's the same name in two different languages. Just remember that, because some people are going to tell you that Jesus' name is not his real name, and it is. It is a translation of his Hebrew name, Yahshua. Same thing, it means Lord, the Lord is my salvation. That's what it means. So if God's name means salvation, why would people want to take his name in vain? Why would Christians want to take that name in vain? This commandment contains far more than warnings of the occasional slip of the tongue. People say, I had a slip of the tongue. Remember the context of God's giving the Ten Commandments? Yahweh is the one and only God who created the earth. So why would we take his name in vain? The God who revealed himself mightily to Israel as their saving God. I am who I am. When Moses asked him, who are you? What's your name? So for the Hebrews at Mount Sinai and for the believers everywhere, God's name means salvation. We should never want to take his name in vain. Another point you can write down is this. Jesus taught his disciples how to pray. You remember that? That's found in Matthew the 6th chapter. Write it down, verse 9 and 10. Matthew 6, verse 9 and 10. And he said this. He starts the prayer off like this. It's really not the words, and this is where people get it wrong. They think they have to repeat these words, like memorize it. That's not what Jesus is saying in Matthew 6. In Matthew 6, Jesus is saying this. This is a pattern of prayer. I'm going to give you a pattern of prayer. I'm not giving you words to memorize and just quote before you go to bed. Like, now I lay me down to sleep, I pray to be. No, I don't want you to do that. I want you to pray as a prayer. This is a pattern. So he starts off in verse 9 and 10, Our Father, which art in heaven. Here's the key. Hallowed be thy name. Stop right there. What does hallow mean? The Greek word for the word hallow means to make holy, right? To sanctify your name. So let's go back again. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Our Father, which art in heaven, I'm going to make your name holy. Holy be your name. I'm going to make your name holy in my life. That's what you're saying. Hallowed be your name. Your name is holy. Verse 10 says, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So watch this. They connected, Jesus connected God's kingdom and God's will to his name, to his glory, to his honor. And this is what Christians really have to understand when we pray. Every time you pray and every time you live each and every day, you are trying to say, I want to make your name holy in my life. I want to sanctify your name in my life. I want to separate myself so your name could be holy in my life. So hallowing God's name creates an attitude and a mindset about him, a submission to his will as God. That is sustained not only in worship, but in everything that we do and everything that we say. So where God's name is hallowed, God is loved and revered. Always remember that. If we hallow his name, if we make his name holy, I guarantee you wherever people make his name holy, that's where he's honored. So that commandment, do not take the Lord's name in vain, is a very serious commandment. Where his name is hallowed, his kingdom is eagerly anticipated, and his will be obeyed. He says, hallowed be your name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. Meaning this, you are anticipating because you lift up God's name and you revere him so that you want his kingdom to come and you want his will to be done. Some people, I said this earlier, some people get caught up on titles. God's name speaks of more than a title such as God, Lord, Jehovah. Those are titles, but remember this, anytime that God is connected, his name is connected to a title, it's still part of God. So if they say Jehovah Jireh, Jehovah Nisi, Jehovah Sitkanu, if they say El Shaddai, Elohim, all of these are titles of God, if they say all of these titles, it's still connected to his name, therefore, you still got to use those names and do not use those names in vain. El Shaddai. I forgot the famous gospel singer.
Marvin Sapp
wrote that, but somebody wrote it before him. Amy Grant, back in the 80s, she wrote that song, El Shaddai, and then other people took it and remade it from her. But it's a beautiful song about who God is. Hallowed be thy name. Jesus identified with God's name, his character, and his purpose. Listen to this, write this down, John 10:14. I'm going to read it for you. John 10:14. Watch how Jesus connects with the name of the Father. He says this, he said, I am the good shepherd, and I know my sheep, and I am known by my own. As the Father knows me, even so I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. Watch this, Psalms 23 says, the Lord, talking about Yahweh, is my shepherd, right? Jesus said again, I am the good shepherd. Jesus, therefore, is the I am of the Old Testament. He is the Lord of the New Testament. He is our salvation. I just can't imagine why people would want to take his name in vain. Did you know if you say anything negative about the name of Allah, boy, they would come after you. They would try to shut you down. But they got all kind of movies laughing about Jesus, God the Father, the Holy Ghost, and the church don't say anything. They got all kind of jokes about the God of the Bible, but we don't do anything. And it's amazing how other religions will protect their names of their gods and their faith and their standards, and yet we will laugh along with people about our standards and our God. He says we can't do that. We can't take the Lord's name in vain. Watch this one, John 10:24. It's Jesus again. He says this. We read, then the Jews surrounded him and said to him, how long do you keep us in doubt? If you are the Christ, tell us plainly. Jesus answered them, I told you, and you do not believe. The works that I do in my, here it is, my Father's name, they bear witness of me. But you do not believe because you are not of my sheep, as I said to you. My sheep hear my voice, I know them, and they follow me. And I give them eternal life. they shall never perish, neither shall anyone snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them from my Father's hand. I and my Father are one. That's Jesus talking about the Father. Jesus connected himself to the Father, meaning this, that Jesus, the Father, and the Holy Spirit are one. They have the same essence. The Father didn't create Jesus. Jesus didn't create the Father. The Father didn't create the Holy Spirit. And Jesus didn't create the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit didn't create the Father and the Son. They always existed at the same time. We have to believe that. It's the second person of the Godhead, Jesus, who wrapped himself in human flesh. So all the I am statements, if you go through the book of John, And you read all these I am statements by Jesus. Guess what Jesus was doing? He was lifting, he was claiming to be God, number one, but he was also making the Father's name holy. It says Jesus says he is the I am in the New Testament. His name is to be hallowed, even the name of Jesus. We should not hear jokes and people in the church using Jesus' name in vain. And if we do, we have to correct them. That's the teacher. That just has to be corrected. We got to teach people that they cannot use God's name in vain. We already read that scripture. There is no name under heaven by which men can be saved other than what? The name of Jesus. Look at Acts. Go to Acts chapter 4. Acts chapter 4. Verse 11 through 12, or verse 11 to 12, it's amazing, two verses talking about the name of Jesus. Watch what he says there. This is Peter talking. He says, this is the stone which was rejected by your builders, which has become the chief cornerstone. Nor is there salvation in any other, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. So, if the name of Jesus is the name that we have to be saved under, why would people want to take that name in vain?
They don't believe.
They don't believe. That's the key right there. They don't believe. I'll tell you, I've never seen so many people use the name Jesus in a negative sense than any other name on this planet. They'll never call out your name when you're doing something wrong and call your name out, do they? Derek Eli? No, they don't say that. They say Jesus Christ. That's the first thing they say. They say it in a negative way. Now, so why is that? I'm glad my brother said that. It's because of unbelief. They don't say that about Allah's name. They don't say that about Buddha. They don't say that about the Hindu gods. They don't say anything negative. But when you talk about God the Father, and you talk about Jesus, and you talk about the Holy Spirit, they got jokes about all three of them. They got their names, using their names in vain all the time. OMG is using God's name in vain. Because you're not using it purposefully. You're not using it in the sense of salvation. And here we just read in Acts that name, you can't even get saved without that name. That's the most powerful name in the world, and people are taking it and using it in vain. They don't even know. I'm glad Jesus said this. I think it's in Matthew 12. Jesus says, by your words, you shall be justified. And by your words, you shall be condemned. So Jesus is going to show them what it took when those who don't get saved. He's going to show them, because they're going to be crying on judgment day. Oh, I didn't know. Okay, let me show you with your own words how you blasphemed my name, how you took my name in vain, and you rejected me, because that's unbelief.
Right.
And you kept doing that. You didn't want to believe. And you used my name in vain. Let me just show you what's going to happen to you. Let's go to another passage. It's a really good, important, very important one about Jesus' name. Romans 10. We call this the salvation chapter. Romans 10, verse 9 through 13. We call this passage of scripture, because we take people to this passage when we want them to get saved. And we tell them they got to do this in order to get saved. And we use this passage of scripture for them. Romans 10, we'll start at verse 8 through 13. I'm going to read it for you. It says, the word is near you, in your mouth and in your heart. That is the word of faith. The word of faith, which we preach, verse 9, that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, think of that name, and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto what? Salvation. Verse 11, for the scripture says, whoever believes on him will not be put to shame. 12, for there is no distinction between the Jew and Greek, for the same Lord over all is rich to all who call upon him. Last verse, verse 13, here it is. For whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. But see, I can't call on the name of the Lord if he's jumped to me. If I put a cuss word out there, I put a cuss word between Jesus and Christ. He ain't like, Jesus not serious to me. Just now you see that they can't call on him seriously if they're using his name in vain. And the Christians, we hear him doing it and we don't stand up for it. So they don't talk like that around me. I don't know. Don't take the Lord's name in vain. You say that around them. I don't want to hear your dirty jokes. We got to stand up and tell, especially they making jokes about God. They making jokes about Jesus. We should stand up and say we don't want to hear it. Try to tell a joke about Allah around a Muslim. You better run for your life. They ain't go to jail for that. They will. They'll kill you. But yeah, we'll let people laugh it off, let people talk about Jesus, talk about God the Father, talk about the Holy Ghost, and we sit quietly and don't say anything. We have to stand up for him, and we have to teach. So once again, we said this earlier, this has to be taught. Taking the Lord's name in vain has to be taught how not to do. And if we talk about it more, then people will be more conscious of it, and then they won't do it. So humbly calling on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and believing in everything that he stands for, that's saving faith. But Jesus got to be real first. He got to be real and serious to you. And if the world makes all these jokes and people are laughing and they're not saved, no wonder the world not saved. And only a few can save because they're using Christianity as a joke from God the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, and we have to take him seriously first, even in the church. That name is taken jokingly, even in the church. And this is what he said, we got to stand up for that. So those who receive such faith and love and honor, we're supposed to. The prayer says, Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. I'm going to make your name holy. That's what you said in your prayer every day. Our Father which art in heaven, I'm going to make your name holy in my life. How do we make his name holy? By living out his commandments. That's the number one way. And putting down those who try to defame his name. That, any questions about commandment number three? Because we're going to go to commandment number four. That was commandment number three, verse 7. Do not take the Lord's name in vain. Any questions? Yeah, I thought that was, yes.
You know, like say if we make a, you know, say somebody said, oh, God, Jesus Christ. Is that cursing him, you said?
Yes, that's taking his name in vain. Mm-hmm. Yeah, because notice how they said it. Mm-hmm. So when they say, when you use Jesus' name in a negative context, it's using his name in vain. That's not a positive context. We used to just talk before you guys came here, talk about Bill Cosby. Used to tell the joke when he was growing up, he thought his last name, he thought his name was Jesus Christ because his daddy used to, Jesus Christ, you can't do Jesus Christ. He said his father used to always do that to him and use Jesus Christ's name as a cuss word to him. So he thought that was a negative, bad thing for him. And you know what? People do that today. They actually still do that. They still put Jesus' name. They will, if they somebody smashed their thumb, they'll say Jesus Christ as a negative context. And then, you know, they use some other words too, but they're going to say they use Jesus Christ. That's taking his name in vain. So we got to learn, and most people I see do that are people who are unsaved, really. I do. Christians who are really involved in Bible study. You rarely, rarely see a Christian take Jesus' name in vain. And they put a cuss word between Jesus and Christ. That's what unsaved people would do. But we shouldn't do it because that's taking his name in vain.
Well, what if you say, oh my God, like
you're. OMG, that's. Yeah.
That's taking his name
in vain. Any part of his title, we talked about that earlier, any part of his title, oh my God, gosh, golly. Gee whiz, all these come from someone said, Jesus. So I see people do that. I hear it all. I was like, people just don't know. And they say it unconsciously.
Yeah.
They just say it unconsciously and they don't know it's not in a positive light. So every time you do that, you're taking his name in vain. Well, I'm gonna say this too so we can get this in a proper context. Remember Jesus said this? You can be forgiven for anything except what? Accepting Jesus Christ as your Savior. What is that sin called? What is it? We call it the unpardonable sin or blasphemy against the Holy Ghost. So blasphemy against the Holy Ghost or the unpardonable sin is what Deacon is saying is not accepting Jesus Christ as your Savior. Now notice what Jesus said in that passage. I said that part first, because above that he said this. You can say anything about the Father. You can blaspheme against the Father, he'll forgive you. You can blaspheme against the Son, he'll forgive you. But you cannot blaspheme the Holy Ghost. Because when you blaspheme the Holy Ghost, the blasphemy is saying, I reject Jesus Christ. I don't want to be saying that Jesus stuff. I don't want to go, no, I don't want it. That's blasphemy against the Holy Ghost, which means now the Holy Spirit can't do his part in your life. He can't save you. He can't regenerate you. And if you die in that condition, that's why you got to go to hell. Not because God want to send you there. It's because you rejected the Holy Spirit's call of salvation. But notice, I want to bring that point, but God will forgive people of using his name in vain. As bad as it is, as bad as we hear people say it, and we hear them say it unconsciously, so we know God can forgive them. It's just our job as a church to train people about, hey, you know, we shouldn't be using his name in vain. Because it's so, I mean, it is an American culture war. It is ingrained in us.
Yeah,
you know, it's,
a lot of people, you hear something, you be like, oh my God. You know,
Yeah, all that. And even using it, and we talked about that earlier, even using it, if we talk more about God in any conversation, I use the example of somebody said, how you doing? And you say, blessed, I'm highly favored of God. Okay, see, stuff like that. That's using his name in vain because you're not serious. You just use it because you heard somebody else say it. It's not real. When it's not real, especially when you're saying it to a sinner, they don't know what you're talking about. Oh, bless somebody, favor of God. Who's he talking about? Can you just say hello? Can you just say, good, I'm doing fine? No, you're in Jesus' name, I'm doing great. Well, I see you in the casino gambling the other night then. So, but you blessed, and I guess you are. You hit that number yesterday, it's all right. But yeah, a lot of people would do that and take his name away. We just got to be conscious of it and just do less of it and take his name seriously.
So somebody was in an accident. We was in an accident, and she said, "Are you hurt, baby?" She said, "No, are you hurt?" "Oh, sweet Jesus, can you take that take it?"
That's different context. You see, it's almost to me, it sounds like you're thanking him for bringing her out of the accident.
Right.
You're not saying it in a negative context. You're saying it in a positive context. You can use it in a positive context, never in a negative context. Another negative? People, jokes in some of these movies about, they call it baby Jesus or something like that. They keep making jokes about that. That's negatively. That's in a negative context. So the fourth commandment. Let's go to that one. This is verse 8 through 11. Time is 7 or 9. Okay, so we have to really take our time with this. This is a very, very important topic. Show you how important it is. It's so important that we got to break it up into three parts. So we got to explain this fourth commandment in three ways. Here's the first way. We got to explain it from the Old Testament point of view, which we're going to start tonight. Then we're going to explain it. The second lesson will be, we're going to explain it from the New Testament point of view, just the Gospels, Matthew through John, and Jesus' perspective on it. And then, the last part of this fourth commandment, we got to explain it in the third lesson of the Church of the Apostles, how they explain the Sabbath. So let me say that again. The first lesson, which we're going to start tonight, is what does the Sabbath mean to the Jews in the Old Testament? Then the second lesson, what does the Sabbath day mean to the Jews in the New Testament, Matthew through John, and Jesus Christ? And then the third lesson, what does the Sabbath day mean to the church and the apostles? So we're going to be here for a minute because, as you know, movements have started on this one commandment. So let's read that commandment. Let's go to Exodus 20, verse 8 through 11. This is the fourth commandment.
Yeah. You want a bottle of water?
Yeah, I didn't see any bacteria. That'd be good if I could, so. I have a cold too, so that's why it's worse than what it really says. I'm trying to get over a cold. It makes it a little bit worse. Also, chapter 20, verse 8 through 11. Let's read that. Okay, it says this: remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. In it you shall do no work, you, nor your son, nor your daughter, nor your male servant, nor your female servant, nor your cattle, nor your stranger who is within your gates. Verse 11, for in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea and all that is in them, and rested the seventh day. Therefore, the Lord blessed the Sabbath day, and therefore that word we talked about earlier, hallowed it. So this fourth commandment, that's the gist of it in Exodus. But we got to talk about it from the entire Old Testament point of view. We're going to start that tonight, right now. It says this. There's another reason why the Sabbath day is a subject worthy of our thorough investigation. The Sabbath is one of the most important commandments of the Ten Commandments. It is a part of those commandments related to our relationship with God and how we worship Him. Remember, I told you this section, verse 1 through 7, all verse 1 through 7 talked about worship, but this one also talks about how we worship God. We're going to see that as we go through some of these Old Testament scriptures. It is also the commandment chosen to be the sign of the entire Mosaic covenant. It's a sign for them. Notice, it was meant for the Jews. See, a lot of people like to try to grab this commandment for themselves. It is a Mosaic covenant. It is a sign for the Jews. We'll talk about that as well. A violation of this commandment is a result, watch this, in the death penalty. If you disobeyed the honoring the Sabbath day, you were killed in Israel. So I think people today are not really taking it as serious as they say they are. Because one day they want to honor the Sabbath day, the next day they don't. Israel didn't have a choice. Either you did it or you were killed. That's how serious it was. Last, learning the meaning of the Sabbath will provide us with the most valuable lesson in how to study, interpret, and apply Scripture. So through this process, we're going to learn something about really how to apply all Scripture, because here's the problem with the world today and Christianity. You got preachers that will take one verse out of context and not put it in its proper context and try to make a doctrine out of it. So, but the way we do it, we go through all the Scriptures, so we talk about it in its proper context. That's proper interpretation, because anybody can take any verse out of the Bible. If you just take one verse and not put it in context with the other verses and make it say whatever you want it to say, you can do that. But we're going to learn today that's not the proper way to learn the Bible. We have to learn the Bible scripture upon scripture, precept upon precept. That's the best way to learn it. The differences between education, watch this, and indoctrination is the difference between a process and a product. Indoctrination is a product. Indoctrination is, I say it, you believe it. Education is, I say it, and you think about it, what I said. And you decide whether you believe it or not. Indoctrination, you don't have no in-between. You just believe it because I said it. That's indoctrination. I'm just saying because the pastor said it, the bishop said it, he said it, it gotta be true. Why did you say that? Why did you find out if what he said was true or not? That's what Paul said. He said the Bereans, they searched the scriptures. This is 1 Thessalonians 1 chapter 8 verse. Search the scriptures daily to find out if what they were taught was so. That's what we got to do. We got to be that good. That's what we're going to do with this Sabbath day. There's so many people that are confused about the Sabbath day, what it means, and should we go to church on Saturday? Should we be going to church on Sunday? And why do we go to church on Sunday instead of Saturday? Didn't God say rest on the seventh day? We're going to learn about all that. But we're going to put it in what? It's proper context. We're not going to take this out of context from what we study. So we're in Exodus. We're studying who? The Israelite people. And we're going to keep it in that context. I can't take the Sabbath day until we get to the New Testament, which we will, even in this lesson, take out of context what it meant to the Jews in Exodus 21st. Let's talk about them first. Then we can talk about what it means to us today. So that's what we're going to do. We're going to go that route. So in this lesson then, we will focus on the meaning of the Sabbath and the Old Testament saints. Let's look at that. So let me see if we get to the, okay, the study. So our study has been one of the birth of the nation of Israel. We've been studying Israel since Genesis. We did Genesis, we finished that. We've been studying that group of people since Genesis. Now we're in Exodus, as depicted in the book of Exodus. There are two crucial passages which we must first consider. So I want you to turn to, somebody turn to Genesis chapter 2, verse 1 through 3, and then somebody turn to Exodus chapter 16, verse 22 through 30. These are two passages that we must learn. While you're doing that, I could drink some water. Stop talking for a minute. Genesis, the second chapter, verse 1 through 3. When you get it, you can read it. And then the next person, Exodus chapter 16, verse 22 through 30.
I'll read the Genesis chapter 2, 1 through 3.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, this is the New Century Version.
Yes.
The seventh day, rest. So the sky, the earth, and all that filled them were finished. Mm-hmm. By the seventh day, God finished the work he had been doing, so he rested from all his work.
Mm.
God blessed the seventh day and made it a holy day, because on that day, he rested from all the work he had done in creating the world.
Wow, okay, that's good. Now, so the first thing you need to know, the Sabbath rest. God rested first. We got to find out what that means. So the second one is Exodus 16, 22 through 30. This is the Sabbath rest of Israel. So we're going to talk about the Sabbath rest of God and then the Sabbath rest of Israel. Let's read about the Sabbath rest of Israel, chapter 16, verse 22 through 30. Somebody read that for me.
I'm reading this New King James Study Bible.
Mm-hmm.
It's written, it came to pass that on the sixth day they gathered twice as much bread, two omers for one man, mm-hmm. and all the rulers of the congregation came and told Moses. And he said unto them, this is that which the Lord has said. Tomorrow, is the rest of the holy Sabbath unto the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
Bake that which ye will bake today, and see if that ye will seethe, and that which remaineth over, lay up for you to be kept until the morning. And they laid it up until the morning, as Moses bade, and it did not stink, neither was there any worms therein. And Moses says, eat that today, for today is a Sabbath unto the Lord. Today ye shall not find it in the fields. 6 days ye shall gather it, but on the seventh day, which is the Sabbath, in it there shall be none. And it came to pass that there went out some of the people on the seventh day for to gather, and they found none. And the Lord said unto Moses, how long refuse ye to keep my commandment and my laws? See, for that the Lord hath given ye the Sabbath, therefore he giveth you on the sixth day the bread of 2 days. Abide ye every man in his place, let no man go out of his place on the seventh day. 30. So the people rest on the seventh day.
Okay. So God gave them, that's the Sabbath rest for Israel. Notice they disobeyed on that day. God told them, don't go on the Sabbath day looking for the manna. They went right out the next day and looked for the manna. He said, God said, how long are they going to refuse me? They went the exact next day. Okay, but so what it said is, thus the heavens and earth, according to Genesis 2, 1 through 3, were completed and all their hosts in 6 days. God rested. And by the seventh day, God completed his work, which he had done, right? And he rested on the seventh day, which we call the Sabbath day, from all his work, which he had done. Then God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it. Because in it he rested from all his work, which God had created and made, Genesis 2, 1 through 3. So the principle, what's the principle of this? The principal contribution of this text is to establish a precedent on which future Sabbath commandments will be based. The work of creation had been completed on the sixth day. On the seventh day, God rested because he had finished the work of creation. He then blessed and sanctified this day because it was on this day that he rested. So that's why we call it a Sabbath rest, because God rested. Watch this. We're supposed to imitate God and rest. We'll go back to the second commandment. Do not make any graven image, right? In other words, don't make anything that looks like me, because that's what the world does. So we're not supposed to imitate the world. We're supposed to imitate who? God. So how do you imitate God? He rested on the seventh day. We're supposed to rest on the seventh day. Don't imitate Israel. I'm talking about Israel. Israel, don't imitate the world. They like to take the things that God made and worship it. Don't imitate them. Imitate him. What did God do? He rested. I want you to rest. I gave you 6 days to work. Israel, you're going to rest on the seventh day. As she read the second one, they couldn't even do that. They didn't even want to rest. But it's even more than that. The rest, you got to understand, God took the seventh of everything that they did. So most of you know just the seventh day. But did you know every seventh year they had to rest? For the entire year, they couldn't work the fields for a year. God said, let the land rest for 1 year. Every 7 years, let the land rest. So in the sixth year, what was he supposed to do? Pick up double. They were supposed to take up enough throughout the 6 years. Well, you couldn't do it that long. So the sixth year had a better crop harvest that they can store up to have enough food to last an entire 2 years for their crops for the seventh year. Isn't that something? And they wouldn't even do it. Not only that, God says, okay, not only do I want you to let the land rest for 7 years, then I want you to take on the 50th year, which is 7 times 7 is 49 plus 1. So seven consecutive sevens of them letting the land rest will get you to 49 years. And then that next year, which is the 50th year, they were supposed to let the land rest again. So every 50th year they're supposed to let the land rest. Every 7 years they're supposed to let the land rest, and they would not do it. As a matter of fact, on that 50th year, it called it this. It was called a year of Jubilee. Now, every 50 years, the year of Jubilee. Not only were they supposed to let the land rest every 50 years, what were they supposed to do also? What else were they supposed to do? They were supposed to forgive everybody their debts. If you had any bills, if you owe anybody anything, every 50 years, all your debts were forgiven. It starts all over again. Man, what if we had a country like that every 50 years? Yeah. All our debts just wipe clean. Government say, oh, you don't owe anything until the next 50 years. No, that's not going to happen. That's why this is how you know people can take stuff out of context. Because I guarantee you, there's a preacher out there that says, the year of Jubilee means this for you. Every 50 years, God's going to erase your debt. They took one verse out of the Bible and said, God's going to erase all your debt. Your bank account's going to go empty. You don't owe any student loans. You don't. Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Right. That's how you can take it out of time. Yes, sir.
That's why I worked out in Saline for like 30-some years. And there's a lot of farmland out there.
Mm-hmm.
And you notice every 7 years, that corn that was growing over here, they wouldn't grow it. They wouldn't grow it in 1 year. In 1 year, they wouldn't grow it. They grow it over here. And it was always a patch of land
That was resting.
That was resting. It was always a patch of land. Is that why?
Yes. Because they said when you let the land rest, it heals the land, it heals itself, it gives you a better crop. That next year, that soil becomes that much better when they begin to work on it again. God is saying this, everything got to rest. Every human should be resting. We shouldn't be working 7 days a week. We should not. We got to have 1 day of rest. 1 day off our jobs. We do. We can't let the workers like that. I used to work in a plant that they let us work 7 days a week. If we wanted it. They didn't care. Guy fought us, keep at the machine, getting his fingers cut off. Because he's trying to make some more money. No, there's laws against that, but what supervisor going to say, well, no, I need this product out. That's what I need. And they let people do that. But we're supposed to rest. The land is supposed to rest. So this principle for resting, we get it from God because he rested. Right? That's one thing. So we can't finish it. We're going to stop right there because we can't finish that. So we're going to see next week. We're going to go into the fourth commandment, dealing with all the scriptures in the Old Testament that talks about this commandment. How does the Sabbath day relate to Israel? That's where we're going to go first. But we had to start with God first because he came up with it. Okay. And so now we know why he wanted them to rest. He wanted them to imitate him. So the rest of the world could see, oh man, they worship that God that told them to rest on the seventh day. Every 7 years, every 50 years, they had to rest. That's an amazing thing. So God worked in their favor if they obeyed the commandment, but they wouldn't obey it. It goes with this. Did you know they went into captivity? They went into captivity because they refused to let the land rest. They worship idol gods. They refused to work and let the land rest for those 49 years. Well, it was like 400. Watch this. When you get to the book of Daniel, we did that book. Daniel said they didn't let the land rest for 490 years. All those seventh year, the seventh of every year for 490 years, they didn't let the land rest. God let Babylon take them. You say, okay, the land gonna rest now. It's going to rest because you won't nobody be there to work the land. So God took it. He got all his time. He said, I'm getting all my time on every seventh year that's how long you're going to be in captivity, which was 70 years for them. They was in Babylon for 70. They meant 70 Sabbaths rest. 70 of them. God said, I'm getting all of them back. So for every year that seventh year that you miss, I'm getting that back. So you stay in Babylon for 70 years. So God didn't play. Oh, he didn't play. They stayed there about 70 years too. So we'll talk about more about that next week. So now you see how that's connected to their Sabbath. We got religions like the Seventh-day Adventist. You have other people who like to worship on Saturday instead of Sunday. They haven't read the Bible in its context to understand why. So we're going to understand why they did it because God told them to do it. We'll start that next week. Any other question or comment about the Sabbath day? Because we'll pick it up from there. All right, that's about his former prayer. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you once again for allowing us to understand the third commandment. We are not going to take your name in vain. And as we begin to talk about this fourth commandment, that we're going to honor the Sabbath day, allow us to understand what this means. Especially as we take our time with understanding what Israel, how they took it and how the New Testament believed in it, and then how it relates to the Christian today. We got to get there, so we're going to take our time, and we thank you that we're learning this process so we can get a correct interpretation of the Sabbath day, and we can tell somebody else why we go to church on Sunday instead of Saturday. As we dismiss from this place, allow us to travel every street and highway, and Lord, we ask for your protection. When we get home, we would like to find everything in order. In Jesus' name, amen.